land issues or whatever the case may be. And you, of course, can talk to them, and our staff will take that encourage and give us a respective agency for them to help.
And economic position, as you've just outlined.
Contractors, too. So they provide the technical know-how, the technical technology.
Sugar is lumped with the manufacturing. How's of the view that sugar...
Deforestation has led to a lot of silting in the rivers, silting in the drains, no proper management of farming.
If something along the line can be done. Once again, I thank you for your...
It has to finish by July for us to be able to input it into the budget. So that'll happen. So we'll start now. Who is getting ahead of me? But this is the economic growth that we seem to be taking from 2008, how the economy has been growing. We have all these are the names of all the cyclones. As you can see, whenever there's a cyclone, there's generally a dip in the growth rate for obvious reasons, because people aren't able to produce as much when there's a cyclone. The economy, as you can see, ladies and gentlemen, has been growing on a steady pace. We talk about the unprecedented growth rate of about for 7 years. It's been growing, there's been no dip. After 2009. We had Cyclone Winston over here, of course, and then because the economy is slowed down, we expect it to pick up again, and we're looking at about a 3.6% growth rate for this year. This is the only the second time in Fiji's history where you had 7 years of growth. This once back in the 1970s. Of course, if we carry on with this trend, then you have about 8 to 9 years of growth, which is not happening before. Go to the next slide, please. Now, what has contributed to the economy growing? The different sectors in the economy. So, this is agriculture's contribution, 0.31%. Fish is 0.02. Forestry is much lower, 0.01. Manufacturing has been quite substantial, 0.56%. Now, there was over half of the growth rate has come from manufacturing. Now, this manufacturing, you know, includes things, we make lots of things in Fiji, but this also includes the production of sugar. Sugar is also in this, but of course we make lots of things now, you know, we make buckets, mops, soap, all sorts of things we make in Fiji now, and that is in the manufacturing sector. Construction has contributed 0.3%. Construction has been quite robust. Mining is 0.04 only. Electricity and water is 0.1%. Of course, they took a dip too because of the fact that Winston, after Cyclone Winston, 9,000 kilometers of electrical cables had come down. So if we put them back up, so obviously the input would be much lower. So the services sector, financial services contributed a lot. Transport, wholesale and retail is the next one. Accommodation. And then you have information communication, which is your mobile phones and all of that. Public administration, education, professional services and other services that have contributed to the growth rate in Fiji. Next slide, please. So how do we, what are the key ways that we measure how well the economy is doing? So you look at the value of the building permits that's been issued. Normally when you have building permits being issued, you know that people want to build. When people are building, that means they have got money in their pockets. So then also, when you build a building, you employ a lot of people, so they have money in their pockets too, so it turns the economy around. Value of building permits in January and September grew by 4.7%. Value of the work in place, in other words, work that was going on, was 10.5. Domestic cement sales went up by 11.1%. Obviously, domestic sales, if you don't buy cement to keep it in the house, by cement to build. Imports of investment goods. Now this is critical because if you see that people are buying or importing equipment from overseas, that means they'll be using it to make things like manufacturing, equipment, etc. Government expenditure improved by 7.8%. So when we improve government expenditure, when we're building more things, we're obviously employing more people, more money in the economy. What are the things that decreased? New investment lending decreased, lending for real estate decreased, and lending for building and construction decreased overall. Consumption indicators. They're investment indicators, these are consumption, they're not things that people spend. The new vehicle registration improved by 27.5%. Second-hand vehicle increased by 7.8%. And you can already see that. There's a lot more cars on the roads in Fiji today. We've got things like traffic jams. We never had traffic jams before in places. New lending to wholesale and retail sector. So people in the wholesale and retail sector are actually borrowing more money. That means sales must be good. That's why they're borrowing to invest in it. Imports of consumption goods. Things that his watch is important, his ring, his watch the gentleman is wearing, the pen he's wearing, he's using, the paper he's wearing, he's using, all of this is important. These are consumption goods. So when we're importing more, that means people are spending more. PAYE collections, that means the salaries have gone up, or there are more people being employed. So that's why this, the PAYE collection has gone up. New job advertisements went up by 15.1%. Personal remittances went up by 5%. This is money that people send us from overseas. We have our rugby players, we have nurses, we have our friends and family and relatives, they're sending money back to Fiji. And VAT also went up, even though VAT decreased from 15% to 9%, the collections in VAT increased because obviously people are spending more money. New lending to private individuals went down. So lending to private individuals went down. You definitely expect that because also after a cyclone, people tend to hold on to money. They're not going to go out and borrow money. So that's one of the reasons why perhaps they contribute to that. This again shows vehicle registration. This is new vehicles and this is second-hand vehicles. So you can see the trend. We like the idea that more new vehicles are being bought. And by new vehicles, that means new technology is being brought into the country. They've got a longer life, but you can see vehicles have gone up. Obviously in Fiji for us, getting a new vehicle is a sign of you doing well. A lot of people like to buy a new vehicle. You know, so my son has got a new vehicle now. So people actually save money to get vehicles. It has, of course, implications too. That means more vehicles on the road, maybe less people using public transportation, it increases your carbon footprint. Those are the kind of things we need to look at. Next slide, please. Again, the retail sales, you can see the retail sales have been improving. Of course, it really went high, and it's coming down. We expect it to come down 2017, 2018, but retail sales generally have been quite good. Inflation, you can see, in particular from 2013, has been decreasing quite significantly. And coming down, it's standing around. But again, because of Winston, it went up. Kava in the Western Division at the moment is $120 a kilo. Even in Suva is, you know, $90 a kilo. Initially, you know, you saw a bunch of bananas costing $5 or $10, $15. Mm. You buy it outside the super fresh, it was like $20 a bundle. You have a shortage. When you have a shortage of goods and you have demand for goods, the price will go up. So that's what contributes to that, but we expect that to dip down, as you can already see, it's dipping down. And it'll come down even further when more fruits and vegetables get more cheaper, etc. Let's just pray to God we don't get another cyclone this year. That'll have a huge impact. Now, this is very important, foreign reserves. Now, as I was saying, the shoes and the watches and the rings that we wear comes from overseas. Now, this money comes from overseas and they're overseas currencies. So foreign reserves is how much money we have as a country to be able to import these goods because we have to exchange in foreign dollars. This is the benchmark. Now this essentially says we should have about at least 4 months worth of foreign reserves for our buying and buying of overseas goods. You can see we are way above the 4 months. We are actually about a little over 5 months. So we've got enough reserves to keep on spending for 5 months in terms of buying foreign goods. You can see where we were in 2005. Way down here, we had only $500 billion worth. Today, we have $1.9 billion worth of foreign reserves. So generally, when overseas banks, when they look at you to see how well the country is doing, this is one of the key things that they look at, is to see how much foreign reserves we've got. So you can see it's been increasing quite steadily. And this is one of the very positive aspects as to where we are today. Fiscal performance. Now, right from the independence days, every year, we've always spent more than what we collect. That's why what we call year in, year out, we have deficits. So only I think only twice in our history, 2 years, but several times, where we actually had a surplus. Now, in the deficit in 2000 was 3.4, 6.2. The higher the figure, the worse it is, the ratio. So we in 2001, 6.2, 5.3, 5.8. Then it went down 3.1. And we've been trying to decrease it. As you can see, there's a steady trend to try and decrease it. But we went up to 4.1, which is this year. If we had to spend $200 million more to rebuild schools and do the agriculture and what have you. If we did not have Cyclone Winston, we'd be sitting somewhere around here, right? About here. About 2%, you would have been. But unfortunately with Cyclone Winston, we have to go out and borrow more. So we need to be, because we need to be able to rebuild. So that's, 4.7 over there. So that's where we are at. And that's the deficit. So we've always spent more than what we collect. But there's good news. We should always try and borrow to only build. I'll tell you why. So our revenue, we also collect them. In 2004, government collected $1.1 billion. This is what we collect. In 2016-17, we collected $3.1 billion. So we've nearly tripled our income, our revenue. And this has been specifically targeted because we're trying to gain more areas for raising revenue. Because we are spending in some key areas that we need to spend. And I'll tell you why. But the good news is that this money that we collect, all of this money that we spend it for operational cost, as opposed to capital expenditure. And I'll explain to you what I mean by that later on. Next slide, please. Okay, what are the things that contribute to our collecting money? So 30% of that comes from VAT. 21% is direct taxes. In other words, we focus very highly. There's a lot of businesses that did not pay taxes before. They were escaping the system. We got really tight on them. Improving the law. There's still a lot of people out there that we need to get in respect of them not being compliant with the laws. If I got people are here, they'll tell you. We're very stringent on them. We toughen the laws. Customs, this is where they pay the duty. Over here too, we think we can collect a lot more. There's been corruption, a couple of people have been charged for that. There are businesses, for example, they'll bring something to the country, they say, oh, it's worth $2 million. Then we say, okay, the duty is 10%. Then you discover that actually it's worth $10 million. So they make false declaration. So before it was like false declaration, and when they get caught, they say, oh, sorry about that, then say, okay, just pay it. Now, we have to charge them. We charge them and hopefully directors get sent to prison so they don't do it again. We think we should be collecting not more here. This is service turnover tax, contributes about 2%. This is the STT that you charge. If you go and stay at a hotel, you stay at you hire a rental car, you eat at a very expensive restaurant in Port Denmark, you pay service turnover tax. You can watch a movie, you pay service turnover tax. Water resource tax, this is what Fiji Water and other people extract water out. They pay the water resource tax. Departure tax, this is $200 that you charge to people, tourists who come to Fiji and leave Fiji. They pay $200 departure tax, of course, the Fijians too. Stamp duty, this is government fees and charges, when you go to apply for license or whatever it is. That contributes 3%. And we have sale of assets, of course, sales of our shares, that contributes to our joint income too. Now, this is the total expenditure we have had in the areas of infrastructure, which is roads, water, electricity, health, education, access to justice, and social protection and welfare. So we pay social welfare to people who are single mothers, abandoned children, people who live below poverty line, disabled people. They are the people who get social protection, access to justice, legal aid. Now legal aid gets about $5 million a year. We set up offices all over Fiji. Education, as you know, it speaks for itself. We've increased budgetary allocation for education, health to infrastructure development. You can see in 2004, they spent $1.3 billion in these areas combined. Today we're spending $3.6 billion. This is nearly triple the amount that we're spending, which obviously needs a lot of money to get up to speed. Okay, This is the part I was talking about. You see, this blue line here is your operating expenditure. Brown is your capital expenditure. What is your operating expenditure? For government, operating expenditure is, see all the civil servants who are here, the salaries, the fuel, the toilet paper you use, the photocopying paper, the hire of the motor vehicles, we pay rent. All of this is operating expenditure. Things you need to run. It's like things you need to buy, you know, in your household, you need food, etc., you pay a rent. Your capital expenditure is the money that we spend to build things, like a road, bridge. That's capital expenditure, that's your asset. So in 2004, the total amount of money that government spent, 83% went into operating, just running government on a year-to-year basis. Only 17% went into building things. Today, we spend 60% in operating, but 40% in building. So you know, the example that I always use is that if you want to go and have a party at McDonald's, you don't go and borrow money from ANZ to have a party. Because when you have the party, you've eaten the burger is gone, but the debt is still there. But if you go and borrow money from ANZ to build your new bedroom to the house, or build a fence, or build a car, the debt is there and the asset is there. The debt will be paid off, but the asset will still be there. That's how you're going to look at running government. This is why we have a huge focus. We've cut back on a lot of our expenses, and we have reduced our operating costs, and we're spending more money for capital to build things. Because building things and spending money to build is very important, so that, you know, the future generations can remember it. So all of this money here, the operating expenditure. Remember, I showed you the revenue that we collect. The revenue is used to pay for this. We don't borrow money to pay for operating expenditure. We borrow money only to build. So we only borrow money to build. For this one, we collect enough money as revenue to pay for operating expenditure, which is a good place to be. Okay, this is how much money the roads are getting now. In 2004, they spent $55 million on roads. Today we're spending $527 million. But that also includes roads, bridges, jetties. In particular, in the outer islands, we're building a lot of jetties. There's a lot of bridges in Fiji that are gone past the use-by date. You know, one of the things that we've had problem we have in Fiji, we may be good at building things, but we're not very good at maintaining it. You may build a building, 5 years, 10 years later, you come back, you see the tile is falling, it has not been painted. Same thing we used to do with our roads. When you're touching a road, you must come back every 3 to 5 years to reseal it. We have to reseal it. You go to soil museum, everywhere they'll do that. Because the biggest enemy to the road is rain. Because when the rain seeps in through the seal, it softens the base. So when the truck comes, it lifts it up on the side, you get potholes. Very basic engineering issue. So, we have a huge catch-up to do. A lot of the roads are failing. They're starting to fail because of the lack of ability of us for a very long period of time to reseal our roads. Next one, please. Again, water and energy. By comparison, they spent $92 million in 2004. Today, we are spending $337 million. Water has got a huge chunk of that. There's a huge pressure on infrastructure between Nausori and Lemi corridor. A lot of people live here now. Nearly a third of the Fijian population lives in the Nausori-Lemi corridor. Nearly 300,000 people. So everybody goes to toilet. Everybody needs to drink water. There's drainage issues. There's electricity issues. So in particular, water is a lot of pressure. But we also started, you know, in the rural electrification before, you had to give 10% contribution. Rural electrification. So we had a scenario where, you know, you may have like 20 houses in one particular area, and they say, oh, everybody has to give $500 each. So out of the 20 homes, maybe 10 will give the 500, the other 10 have not given it. So they don't get the electricity. That's been, some people have been like this for 10, 12 years, 15 years. The money's just been lying there. So we actually have returned all that money. We said we no longer require your, then it went down from 10% to 5%. We said no longer require that. We'll do that as part of our program. There's quite a bit of money that goes there. This, of course, includes the round 55 electrification too, and around King's Road and all of those places. A lot of work to be done in that area. Education, again, you can see the comparison. 2004, $270 million. This includes also teacher salaries, tuition fees. But of course, this has increased here. In 2014, it went from $351 million to $520 million, because we now pay for the school fees. Right all the way from now, kindergarten, all the way to high school. So that costs money. That's nearly like a $200 million increase compared to when we did not pay for school fees. That also includes university, the topper scholarships. There's been a slight increase here because we are giving about 630 scholarships to people. And the scholarships, some people don't understand. We actually don't give people, for example, to become lawyers. There's too many lawyers. We have a shortage of doctors, nurses, marine scientists, town planners, forest conservators, all those science-based areas, land surveyors, town planners, huge shortage in that area. So we're encouraging people to do more of those type of subjects. Funding for health, you can see just by comparison, $132 million in 2004, now they're getting $244 million. That includes, of course, free medicine. One of the biggest problems or challenges we have is that in Fiji, for decades, they have not invested in our human resources. So, for example, at the moment, if any one of us in this room has a heart attack, there's nobody in Fiji who's available 24 hours a day to be able to do open heart surgery on us. There's nobody qualified to do that. That is quite a tragedy. You don't create a cardiac surgeon overnight. It takes 10, 15, 20 years to get somebody to be an expert to cut you open and do all of that. So we recognize that. We want to also recruit more people from overseas whilst we get our local people trained. We now, of course, gave the doctors nearly about an 80% salary increase. A lot of our good doctors, you know, they're getting a lot of good training. They go to the outer island, they do a public health system, they become very good, then they go overseas because they pay better over there. So in order to retain them, we've given about an 80% pay rise to doctors. And we also have, now, if any doctor is employed by government, if they want to start going to university to do postgraduate studies at Fiji National University, we pay for them, it's free. This government believes in investing them because we want them to stay here. So you know, we want our ear, nose and throat specialists in Nausori. We want one in Sigatoka and Suva and Otoka everywhere. So at least the people don't have to travel a long distance to get access to those kind of facilities. So this is a part, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in this area. We've discovered, for example, a lot of the medicine that we buy from Australia and New Zealand, we can buy for 1/10 of the price from countries like India. And we have not gone to countries like India. In fact, I was there with the Minister for Health. We met the various pharmaceutical companies. They're making drugs. Some of them, you know, we pay $30, they can buy from them for $2. But they're certified by WHO. These pharmaceutical companies are making for overseas countries. I mean, overseas firms too. So we need to become a lot more smarter in respect of getting those types of facilities from them. So again, you can see, you know, I talked about the operating revenue and operating expenditure. This is how much we make, this is how much we spend, and this is the operating savings. You can see our savings are increasing. So it's very low here, and this is how much we are saving. So that's a big, big chunk, which is a good place. Government debt. Now, when people talk about government debt, let me give you an example. If, say, we made $100, if our wealth was $100, we went and borrowed $20. Then we will say, we are borrowing 20% of our GDP. 20% of the value of our GDP we are borrowing. So that's $20, or $100 is 20%. Now assuming our wealth increases from $100 to $500, and then you go and borrow $50. The $50 or $500 is 10%. So even though you increased the amount of dollars you were borrowing from $20 to $50, in comparison to what your wealth is, it's still far less. So, in fact, that's what's been happening in Fijian. So, you know, you can see that this is what you call a nominal value. This is the actual amount. It's increased. But as a percentage of your GDP, it's coming down. So, you know that example that I gave. The percentage of GDP, our debt to GDP ratio is actually coming down. It's gone slightly up here, again because of Cyclone Winston, but we have a target to keep on reducing to around about 45% in about 3 years' time. So that's where we want to be. So that's the real scenario regarding our debt. So in summary, ladies and gentlemen, our economy is, of course, as we stated, is accelerating to grow. 2017, favorable growth prospects. We still want more cyclones. We must stay away from cyclones. Hopefully, stay away from us. Increased private sector investment. We have prudent fiscal management and sustainable debt position. We are very mindful about that. Being quite Bamangi where we have to be. Areas that we need to spend investment. We do that. And we've got a much higher capital expenditure and operating savings. Broad-based growth, you can see that we don't want to depend on only one area to contribute towards our growth. You can't just say, let's just depend on tourism, or let's just depend on sugar. We have to ensure that the areas of growth are spread. You know, it's the same way that we talked in Parliament this week, that with tourism, we can't just simply depend on Australia and New Zealand to be our source of revenue. Tourist arrivals. At the moment, it's quite high. Australia is about 51%, New Zealand is about 16%, North America is 15%, the balance is all the other countries. So you see, if your dependency on one country is very high, that means one day when the economy is not doing well, less people from there will travel. The less people from there will travel will get hit very hard. But if you have like maybe seven countries contributing to the total arrivals, if one country does not do well, it still doesn't affect us. So that's where we're talking about. We need to have broad-based growth. The foreign reserves are comfortable. And inflation, yes, it's been high. Vegetables been high. Carbon has been high. Carbon contributes about 2.5% towards the basket that weighs the consumer price index. And but we expect inflation to stabilize in the medium term. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's the short brief in respect of where we are with the economy.